I'm Danita Broyles, and I feel I would be remiss if I didn't take a pause to stop and thank everyone for attending today's event, for showing your dedication to quality of ingredients, which is vitally important in the upstream supply chain for drug products. Not only just hand sanitizers, but many of the drug products that use alcohol as its active pharmaceutical, as an active pharmaceutical ingredient or as an excipient. Next slide, please. As I said yesterday and today, quality matters. Case in point, we've been monitoring the FDA's do not use list for hand sanitizers, and between June of 2020 through just last week, over 220 hand sanitizer products have been added to this list. And they were added to the list for a variety of things, such as methanol contamination adulteration. Instead of isopropyl alcohol, there was one propanol that was present. Some ingredients like the alcohol or the benzalkonium chloride that we call BAK was subpotent. There were micro issues as well. And that was among some of the reasons why these hand sanitizers were put on the FDA's do not include list. And why does that matter? And it matters because of the public health impact during COVID, especially because we're using hand sanitizer now more than ever. And because of the methanol contamination issue in hand sanitizers, 15 people in Arizona and New Mexico were hospitalized after ingesting hand sanitizer containing methanol. And while it seems odd that some people may ingest hand sanitizers, anyone with kids will tell you, kids will put, they'll get their hands on anything and accidentally put stuff in their mouths all the time. So we definitely don't want to see children getting poisoned or dying from accidentally ingesting hand sanitizer. Also, 3 people were left with visual impairments, and 4 of those died as a result. And as Francis Godwin from the FDA spoke to yesterday, there's even risk of toxicity through dermal applications, as well as ingestion of a contaminated hand sanitizer. Next slide, please. So this is a letter from 2010. So the issue with USP and FDA working together is nothing new. They've always collaborated, worked together to ensure public health. And as part of this 2010 letter, FDA encouraged USP to update monographs to avoid what we call EMAs, economically motivated adulteration. And as Bob Lefebvre so eloquently put it, that was one of the reasons behind the recent update to the alcohol monograph, where as additional identification tests was listed for methanol, that way so that every container of every lot received would have to be identified using that methanol identification, as well as the other IDs that were listed in the USP monograph. Why? It was to avoid manufacturers receiving methanol as opposed to ethanol and using that in hand sanitizer. Next slide, please. So as Teresa Michelle and Francis Godwin from FDA spoke about yesterday, I wanted to remind everyone of some information that we pull from the FDA's temporary policy for the manufacture of alcohol. And as you all know, it was issued March of last year, updated in August, that FDA has stated in that document that alcohol derived from synthetic processes may be considered for use in hand sanitizer only if it meets the USP or the FCC monograph. So another thank you again to both Steve Gandel, our foods expert, as well as Bob Lefebvre for discussing those monographs and the recent updates to them. And then just as a secondary point, alcohol produced in facilities normally producing fuel or technical grade alcohol may be considered for use in hand sanitizer, provided that, first of all, that alcohol meets the USP or the FCC grade requirements, and also that the alcohol was screened for any other potentially harmful impurities not specified in those monographs, but they could also be present in that manufacturing environment. Next slide. So as Bob had spoke to today, what USP had done was the impurities test for alcohol was already in the monograph, but USP also made it an identification requirement. As FDA spoke to yesterday, that ensured that when the manufacturers of hand sanitizer or other drug products that use alcohol, when they receive it, they have to perform this methanol identification on every lot and those containers for that lot. Next slide, please. So hot off the presses, Francis Godwin, he spoke to it just yesterday. So some of this may seem a little repetitive, but given the vitally important nature of this situation, I just wanted to bring it up again. Some of the information in the FDA policy that was just issued last week. And the one thing of note was that it expanded the applicability of the issues with potential methanol adulteration with pharmaceutical alcohol. It went past just hand sanitizers. It spoke to things like inhalation products, medicinal mouthwashes, and other products like your cough and cold syrups that probably most of us use during this time of year, because they all contain alcohol. And there is concern that alcohol contaminated with methanol could find its way into those products as well. And again, to reiterate what Dr. Godwin said, methanol contamination, it's not just happening within the U.S. or products received in the U.S. It's happening around the world. And so what was also listed in there was that the methanol test that's currently listed in the USP alcohol monograph can also be used to test for methanol in ICX. And so the FDA did add some caveats about the limits. And then as a last point of that I noted, repackers and distributors of pharmaceutical alcohol should perform testing. And that just continues to protect the quality of the alcohol as it makes its way through the supply chain from the ingredient manufacturers through the drug manufacturers as well. Next slide. Okay, so some other things that were listed in that policy was that many hand sanitizers didn't comply with what we call CGMPs, current good manufacturing practice, nor manufactured their product consistent with what was in that previous FDA temporary policy that I spoke to, or that companies who produce hand sanitizers fail to adequately perform identification testing on each lot, or they did not properly evaluate the identity testing, or that those manufacturers of hand sanitizer relied on the C of A test result sheet or a spec sheet provided by the ethanol supplier without adequately validating that supplier's certificate of analysis. And when that happened, in many of those instances, ethanol was substituted with methanol or was contaminated with methanol. And lastly, some of the hand sanitizer manufacturers could not identify the true source of the alcohol. Next slide. Thank you. So, why is this slide here? Well, as it comes to excipients, this is something that USP has been tracking now for a while. When we looked at the warning letters issued by FDA between 2013 to 2016, there were maybe 3 or 4 that referenced ingredient quality or excipient quality. However, between the years 2017 through 2019, 58 warning letters were issued to companies concerning ID testing of each incoming lot or over-reliance on the supplier C of A for identification testing, which tells you the agency is paying attention. Next slide. And so this is 21 CFR 211. This is the requirement that Francis Godwin spoke to yesterday, where it says at least one test, so it shall be conducted to verify the identity of each component of a drug product. And if you have specific tests, if any, they should be used. And you can hit the down arrow one more time. There we go. And in each, can you go back? Okay, so each component should be tested in conformity with all written specifications for purity, strength, and quality. That means you got to do full testing if you receive your ingredients. However, this regulation does say that in lieu of such testing, instead of doing full testing, those companies are permitted to do, they can pull results off the certificate C of A, provided that they do a few things. One of which is they have to do specific identity testing on all lots that are received. And then those manufacturers have to establish the reliability of the supplier analysis. So, and then it says through appropriate validations of those supplier test results at appropriate intervals. Next slide. Okay, so we're gonna just go over some of the basics, just in case we have people who may not be aware of some of the terms and of the acronyms. I would be derelict in my duty not to go over them. Next slide. So we keep hearing cGMP. I know you've seen it a lot yesterday, today, and in the conversations. What are cGMPs? And this information comes directly off the FDA's website. So if you want to know this information or additional information, always the FDA's website, great place to start. So cGMPs is an acronym for current good manufacturing practices. And these cGMPs, they help create systems to ensure proper design, monitoring, and control of the manufacturing processes and facilities. And if companies use these cGMPs, it does prevent instances of contamination, mix-ups, deviations, failures, and errors. And that's vitally important when we consider that we're producing products defined this way for human consumption or use. And when companies adhere to these cGMP regulations, it ensures that the identity, strength, quality, and purity, that's a phrase that we love at USP, of drug products and ingredients, it ensures that they will be met to adequately control the manufacturing operation. Next slide. And so cGMPs, they're designed to be flexible. You know, when you read about them, when you learn them, there is flexibility. And why is there flexibility? Because you need to allow the manufacturers to decide for themselves how to implement those controls within their facility and to use their scientific sound judgment, because they know their processing methods, they know their manufacturing design and capabilities and their testing procedures. And another reason that cGMPs are designed to be flexible is that it allows companies to use modern technologies and apply innovative approaches when necessary, and to also continually improve, which is vitally important when you're manufacturing drug products. Continual process improvement is a must. Next slide, please. Okay, so this information was also taken off the FDA's website. If an ingredient manufacturer is not following cGMPs, are those ingredients safe for use? So per the FDA, if a company is not complying with those cGMP regulations, any ingredient or drug that is made is considered adulterated under the law. Now, that doesn't mean that there is necessarily something that's wrong with that ingredient or that drug product, but when the word adulteration is used, it means that that ingredient or drug was not manufactured under conditions that comply with the GMP. Next slide. Oh, I love this slide. So if you're a new alcohol manufacturer, and you want to learn more about CGMPs or FDA guidance documents, how do you do so? And so you can always go to the FDA's website, fda.gov, and it contains links to those CGMP regulations, guidance documents, as well as a ton of other information that will help you if you're a new manufacturer for either drug products or ingredients. Additionally, if you have questions concerning alcohol, and especially alcohol as it pertains to hand sanitizer, in these slides we included an email. And then just as a final note, FDA reaches to the public with presentations. They appear at national and international meetings and conferences. And there's even a place for you to sign up to get regular emails from FDA with updates and information. Next slide. Okay, yesterday, Francis Godwin, he gave a high-level overview of what ICH is. And so if you're new to this space, you may wonder, when they're talking about ICH, what are they talking about? The International Council for Harmonization is what we typically call ICH. And so it's an organization that includes 17 members and 32 observers. And it brings together regulatory authorities and the pharmaceutical industry, and they discuss the technical aspects of the pharmaceuticals, and that allows them to develop what we call the ICH guidelines. And that's important because in a minute you'll hear me talk about a specific guideline. And so the mission of the ICH is to achieve greater harmonization worldwide to ensure that safe, effective, and high quality medicines are developed and maintained in the most resource efficient manner while meeting high standards. And it's really important. That type of harmonization is important because coming from a former background in the pharmaceuticals, when there are lots of different regulations, you know, it just increases the complexity that companies have to undergo to release these much needed drugs into the marketplace. So harmonization whenever possible is something I know is important to the pharmaceutical industry. Next slide. And so you'll hear me talk in a minute about ICHQ7. What is ICHQ7 that if you've ever heard me talk about the ingredient verification program for APIs, what is that? So ICHQ7 is a guideline concerning good manufacturing practices for the active pharmaceutical ingredients that we're going to call APIs. And it applies to APIs for use in human medicinal drug products. And the purpose of ICHQ7 is to harmonize expectations during inspections and to remove ambiguities and uncertainty. And ICHQ7, it actually has a pretty thorough, it's a really good question and answer document to address technical issues that some companies may have concerning GMPs or your good manufacturing practices as it relates to APIs. Next slide, please. All right, so supplier qualification. What does it do? What does it not do? So sometimes people may just do a paper audit. And doing a paper audit, it's okay. You confirm that, you know, your suppliers have a quality management system that we call QMS, but it doesn't tell you how well it was implemented, and is that information even trustworthy? And then some companies may choose to do an on-site audit. It's typically 3 days, and it can show you that a company has implemented the QMS, and it shows you the quality of the facility, general maintenance, and procedures, but it's just a periodic snapshot in time for that 3-day period while you're there auditing that facility. Next slide. So we want to let you know that ingredient manufacturers, you're not alone, because I know you've heard a lot of information about what the FDA expects concerning ethanol, the importance of this issue, but we're here to let you know USP has services like the USP ingredient verification services. We have educational courses. We've had two wonderful speakers today discuss what we call our documentary standards. And those are your general notices your general notices, general chapters, and your monograph. We also have reference standards, and as Pete referred to, we have lots of stakeholder engagement events where we really want to let your voice be heard. So we will include with the information that goes out some email links on how you can further engage with USP to participate in many different venues with us and let your voice be heard. Next slide. All right, so I'm here to talk about the USP Ingredient Verification Program and how it helps reduce risk in the supply chain. Next slide. Okay, so the first question, why should a company even participate with the USP verification program? And it's simple. It's a way for you to demonstrate your compliance with the applicable GMP. It also shows that your company can meet acceptable limits for impurities and contaminants. And you can verify your conformance to the appropriate specifications for identity, purity, and quality. And it ensures ingredient consistency from batch to batch. Next slide, please. So the USP Ingredient Verification Program, it consists of three components. So those three components are, we come in, we do a GMP facilities audit. Currently, what we're doing now, due to COVID, we're doing what we call a desk audit / virtual audit. Then we're going to do a quality control manufacturing. So QCM is quality control manufacturing program documentation review, where it'll give us a look into how well does that company implement their quality? Do they understand what contributes to quality? And last but certainly not least, the last component is product testing. And once a company successfully completes all three components, they are a successful participant in the USP Ingredient Verification Program. And then then 1 year later, USP will come back, we'll do all three components again with your company, because we believe that continuous surveillance is necessary on an annual basis. Because even small changes, either in your manufacturing process or any of your process, can have a large impact on quality. So we want to make sure we're coming out on an annual basis. Next slide. Okay, let's take a deeper dive right now into our GMP facilities audit. So the facility audit ensures that manufacturing sites comply with GMP. And these GMPs are based on regulatory or industry best practices. So today we're talking about alcohol used as an API. We verify then to ICH Q7, which we just discussed earlier, which is good manufacturing practice guidance for active pharmaceutical ingredients. If your company makes excipients, USP would then come out and we would verify the excipients that you enter into our program using two things, USP General Chapter 1078, which is good manufacturing practices for bulk pharmaceutical ingredients, which we discussed yesterday, as well as the ANSI 363, good manufacturing practices for pharmaceutical excipients. Next slide. And so a question I always get asked, when the people are coming who are performing the audit, what are the qualifications for your auditors? First of all, they have to be certified to ISO 17020. We're also looking for ASQ CQA certification. We look for people who have relevant industry experience and who have relevant auditing experience, and that they have a thorough understanding with those specific guidelines. And then once we select those auditors, we then provide them with USP specific training as well as USP program specific training as well. Next slide, please. Okay, quality control and manufacturing process evaluation. We're going to call that QCM for short, everyone. That is a mouthful. So during the QCM process evaluation, we're reviewing the following information, things like general information, manufacture. We want to look at the control of the materials. We want to look at how you're using it, reference standards and materials, stability, ICHQ1, USP 1150. And the reason we're doing this deeper dive into quality is that this deep review into documentation, it uncovers quality issues that you typically don't discover during a typical GMP 3-day audit. Next slide, please. And so the last and the third component of our USP ingredient verification process is the product testing. So we will, USP will get a copy of your batch history report, and then we'll pick three random lots and have them sent to one of our USP laboratories. We then perform identity, purity, assay, and any specific test for quality. If your company manufactures USP grade, we're going to do the full USP testing in our laboratory on your materials, as well as any other methods that you have specific to your ingredient at your company listed on the certificate of analysis. And for those companies who claim multi-compendial grade, USP, EP, JP, we will also do a verification laboratory testing of those pharmacopoeia methods as well. Next slide, please. Okay, this may be a little hard to read, but this is the process diagram we have for becoming USP verified. So it breaks down all three components and lets you as an individual know what happens during those three. For example, let's take that GMP audit that we're going to come out and do first. Once USP conducts the audit, then we will provide the participant with our observations. And then the company will come back, assess and address the audit observations. Then once everything is addressed and reviewed, then you'll see that there are similar steps for the quality control process evaluation, as well as product testing. And so once the company completes all three sections successfully, they're considered to be USP verified. Next slide. So this is the good part, right? Once your company successfully completes all three components, your company will get a notification letter saying that you have successfully completed the process. You'll get a certificate from USP of standards compliance. You can then use the USP verified mark on your bulk label and on your certificates of analysis. You can also use the USP verified mark in your marketing campaign. And then USP will provide you with instructions on how to use the logo, as well as what is and is not appropriate. But once you successfully complete the program, that's the good part, because USP, we will also put your company's name as well as the ingredients that your company has verified with USP on our website at usp.org in the verification program section, so that drug manufacturers or people who purchase these ingredients, when they want to be certain of a company's quality of their ingredients, they know when they see that USP logo that that material is quality. It's a wonderful differentiator for the quality of your materials compared with, especially when you see surges in the marketplace. Great way to differentiate your company and the quality of your ingredients in this type of crowded atmosphere. Next slide, please. Ah, the benefits. I love this slide. So, considering that most of us on the line are ingredient manufacturers, and we'll zero in on this. And USP, we offer continuous surveillance monitoring, like I said, because even small changes to to your process can have a huge impact on the quality of your ingredients. And we want, when you demonstrate the quality of your ingredients to customers, we want them to know, because you're USP verified, that USP is coming out and that we're truly verifying that quality. It helps differentiate the quality of your ingredients from others that are in the market. And it strengthens confidence with the people who may be looking to purchase your ingredients that your company is adhering to GMP and product quality standards. It could potentially reduce the number and cost of the GMP audits coming from your customers. And it reduces the risk of inconsistent and substandard quality ingredients coming into the marketplace. And it gives your customers assurance that this verified logo, it comes from USP, which is independent of industry. We're independent of FDA. So by maintaining this independence, we are a neutral party when we verify your company and the ingredients. And it's this program is a wonderful way to make the quality of your ingredients visible. Next slide, please. So here are some of the benefits for finished product manufacturers. I won't spend too much time here, simply because most people on the line are from ingredient manufacturers. But these are great points. Should you participate in the USP verification program, these are great points that you can bring up with your customers as to why you're USP verified and the benefits that it brings not only to you as an ingredient manufacturer, but also to them as a drug product manufacturer. Next slide. So to learn more about the USP verification program, you can type this simple logo, this simple email address, www.usp.org/IVP for ingredient verification program. And then if you click on the left-hand side of the screen, what you'll see is some dots. And when you click there, you can then go to the specific program that you want, be it dietary ingredients, APIs, or excipients. And so what will you see? You'll see a list of manufacturing sites, a list of verified products. What you will see is a manual for participants. And you can even see like the verification summary poster and some educational courses. So we also wanted to make you all aware of USP, our ingredient verification. We've been listed in a lot of recent media and some upcoming media that has not been published yet. So we were recently in pharmaceutical technology talking about COVID-19's impact and how the ingredient verification program can help ensure quality and manage risk. That was a podcast that was done in PharmTech, and you can also download a PDA of the Q&A. Also, we were recently listed in an article in Tablets and Capsules concerning the COVID-19's impact on the number of FDA inspections and manufacturers' risk because of it. And we were also listed in Industry Today magazine speaking to this very topic, hand sanitizer and COVID-19, a public health crisis. Next slide, please. So as I'm wrapping up, I always like to tell customers, stakeholders, just people interested in USP, you do have the power to impact global health. USP does not move autonomously, and we have a bevy of programs to help both ingredient and the drug product manufacturers. And if you're interested in especially differentiating the quality of your alcohol, participate in the USP ingredient verification program to verify and to demonstrate the quality of your alcohol. And as some of you on the phone have been calling and emailing me, you know me quite well. I will answer phone calls and emails at the oddest times of the day or night. So feel free to contact me at danita.broyles@usp.org. I also listed my work cell phone number and the link where you can get to the ingredient verification program. Next slide. Thank you so much again. I cannot wait for the Q&A. I'm very excited to always talk about ingredient verification because it is a potential solution for ingredient manufacturers because it helps reduce your risk as well as the risk of substandard or adulterated products entering the marketplace.